At the end of last time, I started to introduce the GRWP, Girardi-Rumenyi-Vehmer Pearl, or CSL, Continuous Spontaneous Localization model for realization of specific outcomes at the macroscopic level. I'd like to spend the first part of this lecture talking about it in somewhat more detail. I think it is well worth studying, even though it is, in some sense, very much a minority viewpoint right now. But before I go into start getting into slightly messy mathematical details, let me just briefly go over again what the main sort of philosophy of the exercise is. So the general idea is that there exists a universal noise background which is not itself subject to the principles of quantum mechanics, and that's absolutely fundamental. The moment you allow this background noise to be described by itself by quantum mechanics, you're back to square one, basically. So it shouldn't be. The effect of this noise is to inject a non-unitary term into the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, so that for any particular realization of the noise, the wave function tends to be enhanced in regions hit by the noise, reduced elsewhere. The norm of the wave function is not conserved at this level, and it usually decreases but may sometimes increase. So far, everything is linear and you haven't got anywhere. This hasn't got anywhere towards effecting realization. The nonlinear bit comes where you obtain your physical ensemble from the raw ensemble by weighting the different realizations with the norm of the wave function produced on each event. And so, at the end of the day, the effect is to take an ensemble, which is a physical ensemble composed of two widely separated wave packets, and transform it continuously and objectively, nevertheless stochastically, into one of its branches. And this is, as I mentioned at the end of last time, this is basically a gambler's ruin process. If you remember what we were saying about that, if you have a game in which each player, the two players, each starts with a certain number of dollars, you toss a coin, and depending on the outcome, A gives B a dollar or B gives A a dollar. And there's some rather simple theorems about such games. One of them is that eventually one player ends up with all the money. And the second interesting feature is that the probability of A, say, rather than B, ending up with all the money is simply the fraction, is simply numerically equal to the fraction of the money that he started off with. So if I start off, say, with $100 and you start off with $50, then the chances of me ending up with all the money are two-thirds, et cetera, et cetera. It's very, very simple to demonstrate. Okay, before we go on to the technical details, a couple of general points. First of all, the hitting process or localization process is characterized by a characteristic length. It basically has no effect on the quantum mechanical structure below that length. It only operates beyond that. And this is, for the historical reasons, this is usually called alpha to the minus a half in the literature on the subject. The second point is that there is a characteristic rate of hitting. Lambda will come to the precise value of lambda later, but crudely speaking, it's got to be small enough that it doesn't affect the standard quantum mechanical predictions at the atomic level, but large enough that it does give you a macroscopic outcome. Macroscopic, of course, depending to some extent on your definition. Okay, so now let me try to go a little more quantitatively into this. It's a bit messy, I'm afraid, at times, but I think it does repay trying to follow what's going on here. And as I mentioned previously, the best, by far, in my mind, by far the best reference to this is Pearl's original paper in 1989. strongly recommend that. And very clearly written. Let's consider a single particle moving in one dimension. So, standard quantum mechanics, you just write down a wave function which satisfies the time-dependent Schrödinger equation, like so. And let's just rewrite that equation in equivalent form, d psi equals minus I h psi. And let's now do something unorthodox. We're going to supplement it with a noise term, where the noise, so the noise is this dw of x and t on the right-hand side of the equation, and you see that that does not have an I in front of it. So it's a non-unitary term in the Schrödinger equation. I'm being a little sloppy here. The noise, dw, is specified by its statistical properties. And all we actually need to know for the purposes of the further development is the expectation value of the noise itself, which is zero, and the correlation of the noise. It's supposed to be a delta function in time, and it has a non-zero spatial correlation here, phi of x minus x prime, where we'll set by convention phi of zero to be one. So then the strength of the noise is specified by this parameter lambda, and you see that there's a term which explicitly contains lambda in the original equation. And the function phi is supposed to have a range of the order of alpha to the minus a half, and just to anticipate, we're going to be taking that to be something of the order of 1,000 angstroms, 10 to the minus 5 centimetres. So you see that the evolution given by the starred expression there is linear, but it's not unitary. In other words, it does tend to change the modulus of psi squared. Now, since the average of dw is zero, according to this equation down here, so its average is zero, and so on, so the average effect of the noise is always to reduce the wave function. However, there will be cases in which, because of the random statistics of dw, its value will be larger than lambda, in which case it will tend to enhance the wave function. Let's study the evolution of the quantity psi of x of t times psi star of x prime and t under the action of a specific realization of the noise. Now, at this point, you get into the slightly messy statistics of noise of this kind of character. So you have to just take this result essentially on as a standard one. If you use the so-called Itô calculus, then the lowest order in dt, the time interval you're talking about, the differential of the product is given by this formula here. And so if you stick that in, you find you've got some terms in there which correspond to the standard Hamiltonian evolution. But then you have this extra term here. Now, we'll eventually discuss what that's going to be like for arbitrary realizations of the noise. But let's just digress for a moment and imagine that we average over the noise. That's indicated by the pointed brackets here. Then what you get is this expression here. Again, you've got the Hamiltonian evolution. You've got another term there. Now, let's just stare at that last expression, the last expression in here for a moment. Since phi, for distances, distance separations much less than this characteristic length, phi is essentially tending to 1. So under those conditions, this term vanishes. So there's no effect on this correlation at spatial separations less than the characteristic length. However, if you're way beyond that characteristic length, then basically phi goes to zero, so you just get a minus lambda in there, and this just gives you the sort of standard expression which you get from a quantum mechanical decoherence, a straight quantum mechanical decoherence calculation. So you've got, so as regards this off-diagonal part of the density matrix here, the effect does look very much as if it's just simulating straightforward decoherence. Okay? And I think this caused a lot of confusion when the GRW paper was first published in 1984, because a lot of people just said, "Oh well, this is just a one of these sort of standard decoherence papers," and it really isn't at all. It's something quite different.
Sorry, that
yeah.
Correlation
yeah.
is like a delta function, but a spatial correlation is Gaussian.
It could be. It doesn't really matter. In the a typical form of phi would be this, but it's sort of somewhat arbitrary. You don't really have to fix it carefully. It's not. I don't think it's really all that essential that the time dependence be a delta function. That is, you have white noise. They always do. I mean, all the papers do assume that. But I don't think that's terribly essential. Let's now not average. That was just a digression. Let's not average, but stick for a minute. This is where it gets a bit messy, I'm afraid. Stick to a single realization and take x equal to x prime. And then we're just talking, it's a special case of what we said on the last view graph. We're just talking about the probability density as we interpret it in quantum mechanics. So let's call that y of x and t. And then you have... forget about any Hamiltonian evolution. Just set h equal to 0, just for the sake of simplicity. So then you've got this stochastic evolution of y. You know what the statistics are, and since you're at since x equals x prime, your phi is equal to 1, so dw squared is just lambda dt. And therefore, the ensemble averages come out like that. Now, this is a slightly difficult, delicate point here. What we've defined in this way is essentially a one-dimensional diffusion problem with a coordinate, which is y. So it's not now, remember, it's nothing to do with spatial coordinate, it's a probability density you're talking about. It's the magnitude of a probability density you're talking about, y. You have zero drift, and you have a diffusion coefficient for lambda y squared. That's then a problem which is soluble from standard techniques of diffusion theory. There is one catch here, which I haven't totally sorted out in my own mind to my own satisfaction. It looks at first sight, staring at the form of that equation there, it looks at first sight the sensible thing would be to discuss log of y rather than y. If you do that at first sight, what you just get is the straight simplest form of diffusion equation with no drift and a constant diffusion coefficient. Alas, if you then stick that back in again, it does not give you the same results here. And I think the problem is that there's a nasty singularity at y equals 0 here, which you've got to watch out for. But as I say, Pearl doesn't discuss this in his original paper, and I haven't seen any further discussion of it in the literature. He does it this way. So he's able to show that, explicitly that the solution of this equation is given by that formula there. Now that's interesting because this function here vanishes at y equals 0. That is, there's no probability to have 0. Y is the probability density for the particle to be at x and t. What I now have to talk about is the probability of having a given probability density, which is a slightly confusing concept possibly. But that's basically what happens here. So there's 0, zero chance of getting 0 probability density. The peak occurs, the most probable probability density occurs at y0 e to the minus lambda t, and the probability falls to 0 as y goes to infinity. So you notice that, the probability density function is shrinking down as a function of time. Okay? Now, you can do the calculation, as it's missing, I won't go into the details, for the correlation at different points. And the equation which comes out is this. So when the distance between the two points you're talking about is much greater than your characteristic length, then the equation decouples. You can just factorize the expression for the joint probability density into two factors. On the other hand, when you're much closer than that, you can work out the solution explicitly. And what's interesting is that it turns out to contain this factor here. Well, a delta function of a log is essentially a delta function of the quantity itself, up to a factor. So what that's telling you is that the ratio of the amplitudes at nearby points is not changed by the noise. So crudely speaking, what's happening is that the overall probability density is decreasing as a function of time. Most of it is. But the actual shape of the probability density as a function of x is not changing as a function of time. In other words, you're preserving quantum mechanics up to the total normalization here at short distances. At long distances, you've got more complicated things happening. Okay, let's go back now to our two-wave packet problem. Let's define the, as it were, the weight of the probability density in one of those two wave packets. Okay, so quantum mechanically, what we'll be defining is the probability that the particle is in this wave packet rather than that one. Now, I think it's almost intuitively obvious. Important point here. For the moment, at least, I'm going to discuss the case where the actual width of each packet separately is small compared to the characteristic length, but the distance between them is large compared to it. That makes for a simple picture. Well, we found that the shape of the wave packet doesn't change, and therefore the statistics of the total weight, ni squared of t, in each packet are the same as those of y. So I'm basically just writing down, again, what the solution that I had on the last view graph. It's given by that expression there. Moreover, the distance between the packets is uncorrelated, and so their behavior is... the distance between the packets is large compared to your characteristic length, so their behavior is uncorrelated. And so you end up with this rather messy-looking expression here. So if you stare at that expression, you see that, as it were, the typical, almost common behavior is that both the weights of both packets tend to zero, approximately exponentially, with e to the minus lambda t. So that is not really helping you an awful lot. Now comes what it seems to me in some sense the critical point of this. Now we're going to define a physical ensemble by weighting the different realizations according to the total norm of the distributions they produce. In other words, we'll define a physical weight, a physical probability, by multiplying the raw probability by n1 squared plus n2 squared. That's the total norm of the function produced. That's a nonlinear operation. And that weights heavily values of ni which were very improbable in the raw ensemble. In fact, fairly straightforward bit of algebra here, which you can check if necessary. You actually end up with this expression here, and that weights most heavily weighted now around the value where ni is exponentially increasing with time. So I'm sure you can't see through all the details of the algebra here, but just to show you, as it were, that it exists and one can follow it through and work it out. The final physical probability density is this expression here. Now let's just rewrite that a little, and in order to stare at it slightly more sensibly. This is just a rewriting of what I had on the last view graph, a slightly different notation. the physical probability density is the sum of two terms. In the first term, you've got a probability which is strongly peaked around an exponentially increasing value of n1, and multiplied by a probability as a function of n2, which is strongly decreasing, where the most probable value is strongly decreasing. So very crudely speaking, in this segment of the wave function, as it were, all the probability density is being funneled into peak 1 and being squeezed out of peak 2. There's another term which is obtained simply by interchanging 1 and 2. In this case, it's peak 1 which is being drained and peak 2 which is being increased. As time goes to infinity, in the first term, the peak in N1 is moving towards plus infinity, peak in N2 is going to 0, second term vice versa. Now, the final prescription is that you're going to take the physically meaningful probabilities to be not the Ni squareds themselves, but rather the relative norms, okay? Which seems, I think, physically a sensible thing to do. So for lambda t much greater than 1, then the distribution of the probabilities simply becomes you have a non-zero, in general, a non-zero probability for p1 to end up at 1 and p2 at 0, as given by this expression here. Conversely, the probability for p1 to be 0 and p2 to be 1 is given by that expression there. In other words, and this is the nice point, the probability of the system ending up in state I, 1 or 2, is just Ni, the weight that it had in the original ensemble before you started out. So, as I mentioned previously, this is precisely an exemplification of a gambler's ruin process. But let me stop for a moment. I know that's a bit of a mouthful, and I don't expect you to have been able to do the algebra in your heads any more than I could for these expressions. But you know, you can work it out, and it does come out. So, any questions or comments at this point? So far, we've just dealt with a single particle problem. But I mean, I trust you do get the punchline. The punchline is that you do recover the results which you would get from standard quantum mechanics by applying the standard measurement postulate. But it's coming out in an objective, admittedly stochastic, but objective way. I think it's really a very ingenious scheme.
There's no way to redefine it so you get P's directly instead of going via the N's. It seems a bit funny that you have this unnormalized thing and then you just...
That is the difficult point, yes. That is an extra, in some sense, an extra prescription, which is, of course, not there in the standard quantum mechanics by any means. Yep. As far as is known, I think the answer is no. And I suspect there is something intrinsic here, because you... whatever else, you do need some kind of nonlinear operation at some stage. Otherwise, all the usual theorems kill you.
So you have to renormalize
it
here because that destroys the
unit. Okay, well, that's the single particle case. Let's go on briefly to the n-particle case. And once we've done the single particle case, actually the n-particle case is not that much more complicated. So the obvious generalization is that, again, you have a Hamiltonian evolution term for your many-particle Schrödinger wave function. And then you have a noise term, and what one would expect is that you would write down a noise term for each of the n different particles involved. In order that your averages come out sensibly, you'd want to subtract now minus a half n lambda and not minus a half lambda there. And it's natural to impose, just as we did for the one-particle case, the condition that its average is zero, and therefore again the tendency is to decrease the norm of the many-particle wave function. Now, the problem, however, arises: what about the correlation between the noise acting on different particles? Presumably, in analogy to the one particle case, we should have in there a factor which is a delta function of temperature, a delta function of time, multiplied by a function of distance between the two points involved, which is falling off with the characteristic length, as before. But a question arises, should it also contain a factor of delta KL? In other words, should the noise on different particles be uncorrelated even when they are within this characteristic distance of one another? Now, I think in retrospect, the natural answer to that question says, no, it should be correlated. That is, if there's noise there, all particles are going to feel it equally. You don't have a separate noise for each particle. And certainly in the case of identical particles, that would seem almost necessary. So, somewhat surprisingly, in Pearl's original paper, he took the opposite point of view. He said, let's not correlate the noise on different particles. Let's just go with that for a moment. Let's consider now a body such as a microscopic billiard ball. We'll see that later that such things may exist, as it were, with a radius R, which is less than or of the order of the spread of the wave packet. Again, the spread of the wave packet, of each individual wave packet in your initial state, is small compared to the characteristic length. The distance between the two packets is large compared to that. Now, the noise on the different atoms composing the ball is simply additive. That doesn't, just as in analogy to what we had for a single particle, that doesn't change the relative wave function. The effect of the noise on the center of mass wave function turns out to be exactly as it was in the one particle case, except for the crucial point that instead of this diffusion term being simply 4 lambda y squared, a single particle, now 4 n lambda y squared. In other words, for an n particle system under these conditions, lambda is now replaced by n lambda, and that now means that the realization takes a time which is not of order lambda to the minus 1, but rather the order of n lambda to the minus 1. So even at this stage, and we haven't in fact got the, in some sense, the maximum effect yet, even at this stage we find that we get the result. We can choose a value of lambda such that for any experiment conducted at essentially the single or few particle level, the effects are totally negligible. Nevertheless, when we come to values of n of the order of, say, 10 to the 23, whatever we want for Schrodinger's cat, then they become absolutely dominant because of this factor. I think it is a very impressive, to my mind, very impressive feature of the GRWP approach that you don't have to put that result in by hand. It does come out totally naturally from the general structure of the theory. Now, in fact, this assumption that noise on different particles is uncorrelated, is certainly unnatural for identical particles, and in fact I think you could argue it's even unnatural for non-identical particles. And so so the natural thing then is to remove the factor delta KL. And the effect of that then is that in some sense you get a sort of super radiant effect. N is now replaced by N times the number of particles which were within the correlation length of one another. It turns out that life is a little more complicated when, I'm still assuming here that the characteristic spread of the wave function is large compared to the size of the particle. If that's not the case, then life becomes a little more complicated. I won't go into all the details here, but it turns out there's a characteristic non-overlap number which you have to stick in the amplification formula instead of just simply n. Oh, we'll come back to that in a minute. So far I just I mentioned the choice of the parameters in the CSL model. There are two parameters in the generic theory which are not fixed by any known considerations. One of them is this characteristic correlation length. The other is the effectiveness of the noise, the lambda in that formula. And the question is, how do we fix these? What principles do we use in trying to fix them? Well, as I mentioned previously, we do want to be quite sure that none of this is going to affect all the results of quantum mechanics which we know and love at the single particle level, or perhaps even at the by now one might say even at the mesoscopic level. So, at the same time, we would like Schrödinger's cat to end up either dead or alive. We'd like counters to click or not click, etc. So we have to try to fit the parameters in, or try to fix their range, such as to obtain those two results. And by a variety of arguments, the result that GRW and Pearl came up with originally, and which is still largely believed by people who take this seriously, is that the characteristic correlation length should be something of the order of 10 to the minus 5 centimetres, 1,000 angstroms, and that the characteristic hitting time, if you like, the lambda, should be something like 10 to the minus 16 or 10 to the minus 17 per second. Okay. Now, you can, in fact, you can play around with those numbers to some extent. There's an interesting observation made by Adler a few years ago. Adler, incidentally, is one of the other people who's been very involved, Steve Adler. He's been very involved with these general ideas. He's actually got some more microscopic ideas about some kind of sub-quantum level, but it can be, but at the laboratory level, it can be recast, basically, in the GRWP language. And he's made the following point. What do we actually want to count as a macroscopic event which we would like to see happen one way or the other? This is a question actually which will come up again in the context of various experiments. Clearly we want Schrödinger's cat to be definitely dead or alive, but that's, as it were, an upper limit. How small, as it were, an event do we want to count as one which we would like to see either happen or not happen? Well, traditionally, in discussions of GRWP theory, people have usually, I think, taken it to be something like the motion of a pointer on a dial or something of the kind. And that then gives you a fairly loose upper limit. Adler says, well, wait a moment. Suppose that a particle hits a photographic plate, that's going to cause a certain amount of chemical action, as it were, and a certain amount of motion of the atoms in the plate. However, you won't know about that until the plate is actually developed. Now, do you want to count the actual ionization, the chemical processes and so forth, as themselves a macroscopic event, or do you only want to say that it happens after the plate is developed? And it turns out that if you actually say, well, I would like the microscopic chemistry which goes on in the photographic process to count as a macroscopic event, that's a much tighter condition, and you then have to multiply lambda by several orders of magnitude, in fact. You can still get away with it, it turns out. There's a really rather wide regime in which you can allow lambda to take its values and still preserve the standard quantum mechanics at the single particle level and so forth. As I've emphasised, all the motivation of the GRWP theory is to produce definite macroscopic outcomes. And of course, one way of testing it against standard quantum mechanics will precisely be to see whether definite outcomes are produced at various levels of macroscopicness, as it were, and we'll come to that later. But an interesting point is that other than this extra noise term, GRWP basically takes quantum mechanics very seriously. I mean, everything else, as it were, once you've accounted for the effect of the noise term, everything else should go through just as in standard quantum mechanics. So in particular, this leads to a number of other consequences of this, if you like, localization process. Remember, when we had our two wave packets, we eventually ended up with one or the other. Now, that's going to have effects which are not simply embodied in that statement. And in particular, one thing it's going to have is that it causes an energy input. Suppose that we indeed have this noise around, and it's trying to localize the center of mass of n particles within a distance r0. I'll use r0 for alpha to the minus a half here. It's just this characteristic correlation length. If you started off with a wave packet which is much more spread out than this correlation length, and the noise is now localizing it within a correlation length, then that's going to give you an energy of the order of h bar squared over mr0 squared, where m is the total mass. Now, per particle, that comes out to n to the minus 2 times h bar squared over mr0 squared. On the other hand, the rate at which this localization occurs is itself a function of n, and at least for the simplest models, just proportional to n squared, given that you've taken into account this super radiance effect. And so this means that the energy input per particle is given by a rather simple expression. It's just the localization rate, lambda, times h bar squared over mr0 squared, where r0 is the correlation length. So there are no unknowns in this expression, up to factors of order 1. And now if you take the canonical choices, which are something like lambda is the order of 10 to the minus 16 per second, r0 about 1,000 angstroms, and you put m, say, the order of the mass of the proton, that comes out to something like 10 to the minus 43 watts per particle, or if I have a cubic centimeter of material, then an extra input of 10 to the minus 20 watts per centimeter cubed. Now, that is a somewhat non-trivial prediction of GRWP theory, that however you try to isolate your system, whatever precautions you take, you're going to eventually get down to a floor for the external heat input, which will be at least 10 to the minus 20 watts per centimeter cubed. Unfortunately, it turns out that, as people doing experimental low-temperature physics know to their cost, there are other kinds of sometimes random heat input, one of the best known being due to cosmic rays, and the input due to cosmic rays is itself of the order of 10 to the minus 12 watts per centimeter cubed. So you have to do 8 orders of magnitude better than that. That's not really terribly tempting to most experimentalists. It turns out there are other side effects, as it were, of the GRWP scenario. For example, if you have, say, an atom, which initially is in a spread-out wave function, you now try to localize it. That's going to change, it's going to introduce perturbations to the wave function, which will correspond to mixing in a very small amount of excited state. And it's a tiny amount, but nevertheless, it's there. And you would expect then that you get this spontaneous excitation of atoms, which would thereafter radiate, and one could then try to detect the radiation. Again, unfortunately, it looks as if that's several orders of magnitude below the minimum detectable threshold right now. So let me just skip ahead for a moment and ask, what are the prospects right now for measuring directly GRWP-type effects in a simple mechanical body, like a mechanical oscillator, say. For one reason or another, people seem to be very attracted to mechanical oscillators. Turns out that in that case, again, you have to go through the details of the calculation carefully to see what is the characteristic reduction rate. Generally speaking, for inner geometry, you can say that the macroscopic reduction rate or localization rate is given by the microscopic rate, which remember is this 10 to the minus 16 per second, multiplied by some kind of effective number. And for the kind of situation you're most likely to meet in mechanical oscillators, the number in question turns out to be the number within a sphere of the radius of the correlation radius multiplied by the number, what I call the non-overlap number. That's the number which we're behaving differently within the sphere for one state and not in the other state. So that needs a little more careful definition, obviously. The interesting point is just to assess some orders of magnitude here. As you probably many of you know, there was an experiment which was quite widely publicised last year by the UCSB group, where they actually, O'Connell et al., where they actually claimed, I believe correctly, to have cooled a macroscopic mechanical oscillator down to its ground state. I mean, that's a substantial achievement by any criterion, but it's interesting to look at it in this light. What would the effective number be in this case? Well, the problem here is that, you know, you think of this mechanical bar as oscillating like this, as it were. It isn't. I mean, it's really oscillating by a very, very tiny amount relative to its actual width. In fact, in the O'Connell et al. Experiment, the actual displacement of the centre of mass, let's ask the following question. Since they'd cooled, they believe they've cooled the bar down to its vibrational ground state, at least as regards one of the vibrational modes involved, not all of them, but at least one. They've cooled it down to its vibrational ground state. Okay, so what's the root mean square displacement of the centre of mass in that ground state? You're talking here about a macroscopic object. The answer is tiny. It's a few Fermis, basically. So that means, in fact, that this ineffective in the GRWP theory would be ridiculously tiny. You've got essentially no amplification whatever. That's not a good system to test GRWP on. Now, a much more promising system from this point of view is an optically levitated dielectric sphere. And very recently, a couple of weeks ago, there was this paper by the Vienna group, Markus Aschbaumeier and collaborators, where they've made a quite detailed proposal for an experiment which would use this optomechanical levitation. What they basically designed is a sort of Young slits type experiment. But the crucial point is that in this case, at least, you would hopefully, they claim, be able to superpose states of this small sphere, which are different by something of the order of its diameter. Or more. Okay. That's a proposal, it's not an experiment which has been done. If that can be done, that certainly would put you well on the way to testing GRWP in the specific form that it's been evolved so far. So I think that is that looks quite a promising direction in which to go in this specific context of GRWP type theories. Okay. That was really what I wanted to say about GRWP. I want to spend the rest of this lecture talking about the more general question of looking for evidence of macroscopic evidence for or against the occurrence of superpositions of macroscopically distinct states. But before I do, are there any questions or comments on the GRWP?
So at the moment you've done it without a Hamiltonian.
Right.
Yes. So suppose I have a Hamiltonian, there's actually two different energies. Is there another problem with conservation of energy there?
I think it would be no worse than just taking a standard microscopic quantum mechanical system working out its behaviour according to conservative quantum mechanics, and then putting in some classical random field, so acting on it. Again, you would expect some kind of input. Yeah.
I'm just wondering, what's the origin of that diffusion term?
Okay. Let's go back to that. I have to say there are various points concerned with the Itô calculus and so forth, which I haven't got my mind totally around. Well, basically, you see, this is a special case of a more general formula, but this is the effect of the noise in reducing the total, or generally speaking, reducing the amplitude of the total wave function. Let's go back one more. So it basically comes from this term in the this extra term added to the Schrödinger equation. Now, if you ask where does that come from, I mean that's a rather basic feature of the model. I think one can't really answer that that question, at least not at the present stage. I mean, I think Steve Adler probably feels that if his ideas about what's going on at the subquantum mechanical level are right, then maybe there would be some kind of answer there. But at least at the GRWP level. Right?
What kinds of things do advocates generally say about non-locality? How do they deal with non-locality?
Okay. Non-locality is actually a big problem, not just for GRWP, but for any theory of physical, in which the collapse of the wave function is a physical process and not just an updating of one's knowledge. I was planning to talk about that in the next lecture, the last lecture, in fact, because, as I say, it's a much more general point than just to do with GRWP. Okay, so I wanted to spend the last part of this lecture talking about the general question of the search for superpositions of states which you could, by some criterion, call macroscopically distinct. And this is actually a fairly new topic. With small exceptions, all the important experiments along this line have been done in the last 12 years, in fact. Previous to this millennium, I would say there was a considerable skepticism in the sort of professional quantum measurement community that these experiments would even ever work. And it's been rather satisfying, and in fact they have. Okay, incidentally, those of you who were at my PI lecture will find this is heavily overlapping. I basically went through this material there, but perhaps not all of you were. So there are a number of systems on which one could try to look for. I would say we're not just interested in the abstract question of superposition. We're interested in actually gaining, in some sense, evidence for superposition from the phenomenon of interference. So let's talk about quantum interference of macroscopically distinct states, QIMDS. So the most obvious generalization of the traditional Young-Slitz experiment is with molecules. Do a Young-Slitz experiment with molecules. And in fact, the very first experiments along these lines were actually done in the very earliest days of quantum mechanics, way back in 1929. But they were only done with H2, so not terribly spectacular. And it wasn't actually a straight Young-Slitz experiment. Nowadays, the Vienna group, Anton Seilinger, Marcus Arndt, and their collaborators, have put a lot of effort into doing this kind of diffraction experiment with quite heavy and complicated molecules. The original experiments were done with fullerene molecules, C60, C70, so forth. They've since done them with small biological molecules, and I think the this is fairly recent, but I think the maximum molecular weight for which they've now done it is actually larger than this, more like 460. I haven't got all the details of that. It's very recent work. The you do get a diffraction pattern. It's not quite as sharp or nicely defined as we're used to seeing with visible light, etc. But or even with electron beams. But it's clearly a diffraction pattern. A couple of very interesting points about this experiment, I think. I think my instinct, if someone had told me they were proposing to do this experiment, my instinct would be, well, you'd better have pretty good monochromation and collimation devices, otherwise it's not going to work. Well, it turns out not so. It turns out that because of the specific properties of molecular beams issuing from ovens, it is essentially well collimated enough, even without any kind of external aid. So you do get something recognisably a diffraction pattern there. One thing I think I'm correct in saying, maybe someone can correct me on this, as far as I know, the Vienna group so far has not conducted an experiment in which they deliberately blocked one of the two slits, and just to compare the two slit pattern with a single slit pattern. I think it would be interesting to do that, just to make sure, absolutely sure, that everything is working. Second point, I think, which is very interesting, has to do with which way effects. The oven is at something like 900 to 1,000 K in the original experiments. Now, you're talking about a complex object, a fullerene molecule or something similar. It has lots and lots of internal vibrational modes. Now, one's first instinct is to say, well, that doesn't matter because the center of mass motion will decouple from the internal motion. So you can invoke, at first sight it's tempting to invoke what I call the Divers theorem, the theorem which says that if a body is moving in free space or even falling freely in a gravitational field, then the motion of the centre of mass decouples from the internal motion, which is, of course, why divers can perform all these pirouettes as they fall, so forth. The fact that their centre of mass is accelerating uniformly doesn't hurt. And that's true in classical mechanics, it's true in quantum mechanics. Unfortunately, however, this argument doesn't work. Or not, doesn't work entirely here, because some of those modes, internal modes of the fullerene molecule, are infrared active, and you can calculate that as a given molecule goes through the apparatus, several quanta of infrared radiation are emitted and absorbed. Now, at first sight, you'd say, well, surely that constitutes, after all, I can in principle tell, I ought to be able to tell just where that photon was emitted or absorbed. That will constitute a which way measurement. Doesn't seem to. I still get my diffraction pattern. Right. And the answer, of course, to that difficulty is a rather neat one. If you actually look at the wavelength of the radiation emitted, in the original experiments, it was large compared to the distance between the slits. It's not an effective which-way measurement. In later version of the experiments, they actually, first of all, they heated the oven, which doesn't have a huge effect, but they also increased the distance between the slits by a factor of 10 or so, and sure enough, the effect went away. No more interference. Very neat illustration of which-way effects and when they do and don't work. Just stop me any time if you have questions on these specific examples. Second example, it's a pretty old one actually. This is the one case, the one example of a claim to, well, the one halfway credible example, I should say. There are other claims around which I don't think are probably worth discussing in the literature, but it's the one possibly credible example of a claim of seeing quantum interference of reasonably macroscopically distinct states which predates the year 2000. This has to do with magnetic biomolecules. It's the work of David Avshalom's group at IBM Yorktown in the early and mid-90s. So the system in this case is a set of molecules. The molecule in question is horse-spleen ferritin. It's a rather complicated biochemical molecule. It has a sheath of biochemical organic material, which is magnetically inert. And then the core is something like 5,000 iron spins. It turns out that these are mostly coupled antiferromagnetically, but there is a slight ferrimagnetic tendency. In other words, there is a certain overall moment, though nothing like 5,000. It's more like 200 more magnetons. However, the point here is that as far as is understood, these spins are very tightly coupled together. So at first sight, you should have a unique ground state, but then you figure, well, wait a moment, the coupling does respect time reversal invariance. So if I have one possible orientation of these each of these spins, I should be able to turn each of them around, turn them around collectively, and get another possible state, which is degenerate with the first. Then, if you believe that, then the question arises, could you actually see evidence for a quantum superposition of this and this? It is taken for granted when you discuss this that you can exclude the possibility that there are all sorts of individual spin reversals. So you've got to reverse all of them or none. It turns out that you can do a simple theory based on various ideas developed in the macroscopic quantum theory of magnetism. And you find that if indeed such a possibility occurs, then you should get the characteristic ammonia type tunneling between these two states. And the frequency should involve a prefactor and then a WKB type exponent. And the WKB exponent involves various anisotropy factors, K and J. It also involves, and this is the significant point, it does involve the total number of spins involved here. So Avshalom's group did experiments on the linear susceptibility of this system and also the noise spectrum. And what they found was that above about 200 millik, everything was pretty featureless. But below about, this should I think be 200 millik, a sharp peak started to develop at a resonant frequency of about 1 megahertz. And they observed two interesting things about this. First of all, they observed that if they applied an external magnetic field so as to break the time reversal invariance of the system, then what you would expect, if this picture is right, what you'd expect is a quadratic Pythagorean type formula. That the resonant frequency would then be the original one plus m squared h squared. And indeed, that did seem to be coming out in the data. The second point is that eventually, horse spleen ferritin actually by itself is not terribly informative because basically n, the number of iron spins is fixed. But since these days, the original experiments, people have got better at making ferritin in the laboratory and they can vary the number of spins. And when they do, they found that the log of the exchange frequencies, it's really log delta, I think. Do I mean that? No, I think that's fine as it stands. The log of this frequency is a constant minus b times n. So that's, again, seemed a non-trivial observation. It did suggest that something involving a macroscopic quantum tunneling process was going on here. I have to say, there's been a lot of controversy about those experiments in the literature. I don't think anyone doubts the raw data is correct, but the interpretation has been very controversial. And in particular, at least one group has claimed that you can actually try to calculate the numbers which go into that formula, and they're something like 13 orders of magnitude off what is actually seen in the experiment. It's one of these situations, unfortunately, where there's a strong tendency to ask, well, what else could it be? But the problem is that in this kind of complicated situation, there are really quite a lot of other things it could be, I think. So I think one has to regard that as having a question mark over it. Yeah.
So is 5,000that I think that's
about the best you can do. Certainly the best that the horse can do. Whether you can do better in the laboratory, I'm not sure. But I think most of the experiments have gone down from 5,000. Incidentally, of course, if you pushed it up a lot more, you'd be getting down into the kilohertz frequency range, and there, I suspect there'll be very strong experimental problems. You know. There's a very interesting series of experiments which are sort of at least tangentially relevant to this, although they weren't done with this originally in mind. These are the experiments of Eugene Polsik's group in Orhus a few years ago. What they were actually interested in some sense, doing a macroscopic version of the EPR Bell experiment. And so they had two masses of gas, which each contained something like 10 to the 12 cesium atoms. And if you think about the angular momentum of those atoms, then you can write down sort of standard quantum mechanical expressions. The commutator of Jx and Jy for either gas separately or for the total satisfies the usual commutation relations. And from that you can deduce that the dispersion in the x and y components of angular momentum of each either of the gases separately or of the total is greater than or equal to the Jz. Now suppose we set up a situation, I won't say how we do it right now, but suppose we set up a situation such that the z component of the two gases is equal and opposite, Jz1 is minus Jz2. Then you can have a situation where the uncertainty, sorry, there's some J's missing in this formula, I think you can see what it means, the dispersion in Jx and Jy for each of the gases separately is non-zero, but the total angular momentum has dispersion zero. So it's a typical EPR type of setup. Now, so to get that conclusion, of course, you do have to apply a lot of quantum mechanics. And of course, there's also a lot of detailed quantum mechanics which goes into the question of how I actually see what the angular momentum is. That's some rather non-trivial quantum optics goes into that. But anyway, the outcome seems to say that indeed the correlation for the two clumps of gas together is essentially zero. In other words, the spread in the x component of total angular momentum is zero, which means that delta Jx1 is exactly anticorrelated with delta Jx2. That in turn means that the state must be either a superposition or a mixture of states in which gas 1 has a large value, Jx1, order n, gas 2 has the opposite. The mixture, however, will not give the other results you need. One can conclude, again, on the basis of a lot of quantum mechanics, conclude that the state must be a superposition of this form. And if you ask how large is little n in that formula, it turns out that it has appreciable weight for n less than about capital N to the half. In other words, you have got here a state which, in my language, has high disconnectivity. That means, crudely speaking, that very large numbers of individual atoms behaving differently in the two branches of the superposition. As I say, from the point of view of the QIMDS program, this is not a complicated experiment. It's not the simplest one could do. And one thing I think one does have to notice is that you can draw these conclusions, but you can only draw them by using quantum mechanics. So it's fine if what you want to say is that quantum mechanics is working. If you want to say that something else is not working, then it really isn't terribly good for this purpose. Furthermore, the disconnectivity in this case is scaling, not with the total number of atoms involved, but as the 1/2 power. So it looks as if it's going to be difficult to get numbers much larger than the ones that they've actually got in the existing experiment. Finally, I come to what's been the workhorse of this game for the last 10 or 15 years, which is Josephson devices. So let me just give a very, very brief sketch of what goes on there. The simplest kind of device which can be used for this kind of experiment is one in which you have a simple superconducting ring interrupted by a single Josephson junction. This is the simplest kind of so-called RF squid. Then it turns out, if I impose a correct amount of external flux through that system, then it turns out there are two The ground state is twofold degenerate. The states in question are related by time reversal. One of them corresponds to a current of approximately 1 microamp circulating clockwise, the other to the same current circulating anticlockwise. And so what one would like to try to do is to generate and get evidence for a quantum superposition of these two states. How does one see evidence for that kind of superposition? Well, the earliest evidence was spectroscopic. If you suppose that you did not have this kind of quantum superposition, suppose you just had a classical mixture of the two states, then the energy levels of your system would be represented by the PECT black lines there. And you can actually, you ought to be able to detect that by a spectroscopic absorption experiment. If on the other hand you believe that you really have a quantum superposition, then you get the standard level repulsion effect, you should get the solid green lines. Again, should be able to detect it spectroscopically. Two experiments way back in 2000 did that experiment and did get evidence for the solid green lines. That's not so spectacular. Since then, there have been a number of experiments involving, among other things, real-time oscillations. In other words, you start the system in one of your two states, leave it to itself, come back and look where it's got to at a later time, and you should see some kind of oscillating graph for that. And these, there have been a number of experiments along those lines over the last 10 years or so. This is largely, I should say, this program has been able to piggyback on the quantum computing business, because people are now, of course, as you know, taking very seriously, as they did not, in fact, previous to 2000, taking rather seriously the idea that some of these superconducting devices might be useful as qubits in a quantum computer. So anyway, there's been a lot of experiment on them. And in particular, people have looked for these ammonia-type oscillations in Ramsey fringe experiments. If you'd asked me to bet in 1999 how many coherent oscillations you'd see, I think I would have said, well, you'll be lucky to see if you see even two or three. There's going to be a lot of decoherence and damping going on in these systems. Well, here is actually an experimental graph. This is, now, you have to be careful interpreting this graph. This is a Ramsey fringe experiment, but these are not, in fact, the ammonia-type oscillations that you're seeing here. But you see that even these go on for much more than two or three, right? In fact, if you figure out what's actually going on, the ammonia-type oscillations are going on for something like 500, in fact. It's really surprising that you can have this highly coherent phenomenon in an environment where you'd think you've got so much decoherence. But it does look as if you are. Let me finally conclude this lecture with sort of review of where we've got to with the various systems. Now, this raises the question, how do we, in some sense, find a figure of merit for the concept of macroscopically distinct? And I have to say, I don't think really this is a terribly important question. I think once you've got the motivation to do the experiments, then it doesn't, not really a lot of point in arguing whether a particular quantum optics setup was more macroscopic or less macroscopic than the mechanical oscillator and so forth. Let's just try to make a brief shot at it. Do we have an extensive physical quantity which in the two branches of the alleged superposition is different by some reasonably large number in typical atomic units? So for example, in the case of the squid, you might take your macroscopic quantity to be the circulating current or perhaps the magnetic moment or whatever. Okay? The question is, if you express this in some kind of natural atomic units, is it of the order of 10 to the 6th, 10 to the 9th, whatever? Okay, that's one possible criterion. So that's what I call extensive difference. By itself, I believe that's not enough to conform to our intuitive idea of macroscopically distinct states. If I think about a neutron interferometer, then the appropriate length scale is presumably something like the Bohr radius. In my neutron interferometer, the two beams are separated. That is, the position of the center of mass in the two branches is separated by something of the order of probably a meter or so. So that's something like 10 to the 9 atomic units. But am I prepared to call the neutron interferometer an example of quantum superposition of macroscopically distinct states? I think most people would say no. Okay, so I do want something else. And what I want, the other thing I want, I think, is intuitively how many particles are behaving appreciably differently. How many microscopic particles are behaving appreciably differently in the two branches of my superposition? Now, that again is not an entirely clear-cut question, but let's just try to make a rough stab at seeing how many are. In some cases, it's quite clear. In others, much more ambiguous. For a single electron, trivially, both numbers are just one. For a neutron in an interferometer, the extensive difference, as we've seen, is about 10 to the 9, but you're still only talking about one neutron at a time, so that's just one in the right-hand column. In the sort of experiments which Serge Haroche and collaborators do in QED cavities, they're very beautiful experiments involving small numbers of atoms, small numbers of photons. They've reached numbers of the order of, I should say, 10 in both branches. In the Cooper pair box, one type of superconducting device, the extensive difference is something like 10 to the 5. You're basically talking about displacing a single Cooper pair over something like a micron in space. But again, you're only talking about one Cooper pair, so that just puts 2 in the second column. The C60, both numbers, around 1,100, probably a little larger now. Ferritin, if the interpretation of the raw data is right, maybe 5,000. The Orbis quantum optics experiment, something like 1 million in both columns. These squids are unfortunately more ambiguous. I'll talk about this in slightly more detail next time, but depending on how exactly you define your criterion for behaving differently, as it were, you can get numbers as small as 10 to the 4 or as large as 10 to the 10 in that second column. But in the first column, I think you rather certainly, if you take your extensive quantity to be the magnetic moment, then certainly the magnetic moments associated with these two states are something like 10 to the 9 or 10 to the 10 in units of the Bohr magneton. So at least you've got a large number in that column. So far, all I've given you is evidence that quantum mechanics does seem to be working, or at least that we do see the experimental consequences predicted by quantum mechanics. That's very different from saying that quantum mechanics must be the truth, right? From a purely logical point of view, no finite number of experiments could ever prove that quantum mechanics was right. However, if you're a Popperian, as I tend to be in my philosophy of science, with certain caveats, a finite number of experiments could prove that a certain class of experiments, a certain class of theories was wrong. So what we'll try to do, and what I'll talk about mostly in the last lecture, is we'll try to define a class of theories about the world which are different from quantum mechanics and in principle make different predictions, and then see how far we can get, how far we have got and how far we could get in demonstrating that such theories are actually wrong. It probably won't take the whole hour and a half, I suspect, so we can perhaps have a bit of free discussion at the end of the day. But I will address this point which you, some of people have raised about the problems with locality in not only GRWP but more generally physical reduction theories.
So these two parameters are kind of equally important?
Look, I think it's very much a matter of taste. I frankly feel that, I should say there's a bit of history here. In my earliest writings on the subject, which go back to about 1980 or so, I put a certain amount of emphasis on this question of macroscopically distinct, what we mean by macroscopically distinct and so forth. And the reason for that was that at that time, there were a lot of people who would jump up at conferences and object to this whole program of research, basically saying, look, we already know that quantum mechanics works on the macroscopic scale. Look at lasers, look at superconductors, look at superfluid helium, etc., etc. And what I had to try to persuade them was that the aspect of quantum mechanics which was being tested in experiments on superconductors or lasers had nothing to do with, as it were, the Schrodinger's cat problem. So what I was trying to do was to define in some sense an intuitive measure of Schrodinger's cattiness, if you want to call it that. I mean, I think that that was really to motivate, to Luckily, it turned out, I should say, right away, that all these objections were coming from departments of theoretical physics or mathematics or whatever. They were not coming from experimental physicists. Experimental physicists were much more open-minded about this, and so they didn't really need any persuading. But anyway, once they had been persuaded to actually start this line of experimentation, the question of, you know, exactly how much more macroscopic or less is the squid than the ferritin or whatever, it seems to me really not worth spending an awful lot of time on. I mean, the experiments now are there. That's the main thing. Well, yeah, but I mean, you see, I think in some ways that's when the maximum threshold for which we could say the maximum number of coupled particles for which we could say that quantum mechanics was working, when that maximum number was 2, as it was in basically in 1999, then to push it up to 10^6 or 10^9 seemed to be a reasonable program. To push it now that we've got it at 10^9, to push it to 10^10 or 10^11 doesn't seem quite so urgent, as it were. And I think one should, tend to try to look for more subtle measures, as it were, of what are the interesting interesting axes along which to go.
I mean, if we push it to 10^25 to the cat, that would convince a lot of people.
Yes. I think even if you can push it to the level of these optically levitated particles, it would be pretty spectacular. Because, as you see, none of these, I should say right away, I think you can see immediately, none of these systems which I've mentioned actually test the specific GRWP scenario. And the reason they don't test it is rather straightforward. GRWP puts enormous emphasis on the center of mass variable. Now, if you're talking about a mechanical oscillator, of course, you can talk about, or a levitated, optically levitated dielectric particle, then, of course, the center of mass may be behaving rather differently in the two states. However, in none of these cases is the center of mass, well, with the exception of the fullerene experiments, but then they're very small on this scale, as it were. So in the others, in the ferritin, in the quantum optics case, and in the squids, there's no question of displacement of the center of mass between the two branches. So they're not good for testing this specific alternative theory. And that's one of the things we have to, of course, try to plan for in the future.
But is that center, using the center of mass, is that really fundamental?
Well, that's a good question. I mean, if you read the literature by the original proponents, GRWP, and also by people like Adler and so forth, it does seem they put a lot of emphasis on this. I think it's a bit unnatural. I mean, I think I would take the view that you know, there's no reason why, say, the circulating electrical current shouldn't be just as fundamental as the center of mass. In any case, it may be possible to pretty up some of these experiments to cope with that. I have a student who's working, or ought to be working at least, on a possible proposal to take the squid experiments and hang a little magnet above them so that when the current was one way, it got drawn down and up. It looks like a very difficult experiment, but we still have to work out the details.